Good morning, everyone. Before we start our service, I just want to let you know Corey is not here today, so sing. Corey got contact traced for being close to somebody who had COVID, and he's now testing him, so his test results haven't come back. We, of course, pray that they will be negative, which I'm pretty sure they will be, but nonetheless, Corey's not here today, so we need to have your voices today, please. That would be nice.
Thank you.
microphones didn't work at all at 8 o'clock, so it's like, whoa, hi, here we all are. It's welcome, we're glad to have you here on this Labor Day weekend. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, unto you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Grant us, O Lord, to trust in you with all our hearts. For as you always resist the proud who confide in their own strength, so you never forsake those who boast of your mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. Say to those who are of fearful heart, be strong, do not fear, here is your God. He will come with vengeance, with terrible recompense, he will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. For the waters shall break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty springs of water. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read together in unison the portion of Psalm 146 appointed for today. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hope is in the Lord their God. James. My brothers and sisters, do you with your acts of favoritism really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? Or if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, "Have a seat here, please," while to the one who is poor you say, "Stand there or sit at my feet," have you not made distinction among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But if you have dishonored the poor, is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scriptures. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. For the one who said, "You shall not commit adultery," also said, "You shall not murder." Now, if you do not commit adultery, but if you murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and act as those who are being judged by the law of liberty. For judgment will be without mercy to anyone who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, "Go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill," yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what good is that? So faith, by itself, if it has no works, is dead. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there, yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile, of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. But she answered him, Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. Then he said to her, For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter. So she went home and found the child lying on the bed and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his fingers into his ears, and spat and touched his tongue. Then looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, Ephphatha, that is, be opened. And immediately his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one, but the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak. The Gospel of our Lord. Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless our hearts and minds so that only your word may be spoken and only your word may be heard. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. In our lectionary cycle this year, we've been reading from the Gospel of Mark. We took off 4 weeks in August to read from John, but with last week's readings, we returned to Mark's Gospel. With that brief hiatus, it's sort of easy to lose track of the overall story. So let's briefly review in order to form some context for our reading today. Jesus is in the midst of his earthly ministry. He has preached, performed miracles and healed. He has sent out his disciples to spread the word, and they have returned from their trips full of excitement and stories of what they have seen and heard and done. In Mark 6, we read that Jesus tells them, Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while. For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. So the disciples left by boat, but of course they were seen, and a great crowd of people followed them. When Jesus arrives at the deserted place, an enormous crowd awaits him. We then hear the story of the feeding of the 5,000. Now it seems to me that if you're looking for peace and quiet, miraculously providing copious amounts of free food may not be your best strategy. But Jesus tries again. He withdraws into the mountains to pray and tells the disciples to go find another deserted place. They jump into the boat and take off, but once again they are recognized when they make landfall, and again Jesus is met by a crowd. Now, Jesus really needs to be alone with his disciples. It's not about being tired as much as it is about needing downtime. The disciples need to process all that has happened and all that is going on. Jesus needs time to personally teach and train his disciples to prepare them for what is to come and to equip them for the ministry that is to be theirs after his death. So Jesus decides to get out of town. There is no place in Galilee that he can go without drawing a crowd. So he heads for Tyre. Tyre is a Phoenician city on the Mediterranean Sea, about 40 miles northwest from the Sea of Galilee. Thus, Jesus withdraws to the land of the Gentiles, where he will not draw such large crowds. After some time spent in Tyre, Jesus heads home. But the scripture is a little deceptive if you don't know the geography of the region. Our reading today states that Jesus returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee in the region of Decapolis. The issue is that Sidon is 26 miles further up the coast. It's the opposite direction from home. The Decapolis is a loose collection of 10 Roman cities spreading from Damascus in Lebanon down to Philadelphia down by the Dead Sea. And with one exception, all of the cities are on the east side of the Jordan River, opposite from Judea. So basically, this is similar to going from Silver City to Las Cruces by way of Albuquerque and Cloudcroft. The journey is a couple hundred miles instead of the original 40. And it is this journey that is the backdrop for today's gospel. Now for us, this sounds a little painful. I mean, how often do we walk over 100 miles? But for a Jew, this is almost unthinkable. And it has nothing to do with distance. Last week's gospel dealt with clean and unclean foods. Jesus taught the crowd that it is what came out of a man and not what went into a man that made him unclean. But Jewish rules of hygiene went far beyond food. People themselves were clean and unclean. Dead people were unclean. Lepers were unclean. Menstruating women were unclean. Wounded people were unclean. And most of all, Gentiles were unclean. Jews did not associate with Gentiles. For Jesus to travel out of Galilee to the great port cities of the Gentiles was totally unusual and unexpected. We can speculate that perhaps, in addition to finding a private space, Jesus was making the point that the Gentiles were also clean, except when their behavior made them not so. Jew and Gentile were alike in this respect. But at any rate, we have two stories from this trip that detail Jesus' interaction with some Gentiles. First, we meet the Gentile woman, a Syrophoenician. The fame of Jesus has preceded him, and this woman has heard of him, and she is on a mission. She wants healing for her daughter. She comes to Jesus, and throwing pride and caution to the wind, she falls at his feet and begs him to heal her daughter. His response to the woman in her distress is really kind of cringeworthy. He listens to her, and then he calls her a dog. He actually calls all Gentiles dog. The statement that it is not fair to take the food of the children and throw it to the dogs refers to the Jews as children and the rest of the humanity as dogs. Really? At first look, could any statement be more elitist or racist? It is hard not to look at the situation and think that Jesus is a bigot. And yet we believe Jesus to be without sin and to always hold people dear in his heart. So there must be a little more to this than appears on the surface. In Matthew's gospel, Jesus says, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." Mark's gospel has the response a little softer. And then Jesus says, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." The NIV translation is even a little milder. "First let the children eat all they want, for it is not right to take the children's food and toss it to their dogs. The woman replies that even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. Jesus recognizes her logic and heals her daughter. Let's look at some of the religious and cultural nuances here. Jesus was sent to the Jews. As God's chosen people, the Jews are to be the stepping stone for God's plan for the salvation of the world. Jesus has been sent to initiate that plan. The essence of his response to the woman is that his time and energy must be spent on the work that he was given by his Father. This is made much clearer in Mark's Gospel, where Jesus says the children must be fed first. Not that the food was only for the children, but there was an order to be followed. There was a priority. Secondly, when Jesus referred to the dogs, he did not use the generic word for dogs of the street. He used a diminutive form of the word. The word he used is the word designating the little lap dogs of the house, a favorite pet that was part of the family. He used a word of affection, not necessarily one of insult. Now, I don't know about any of you, but we have one of those little household dogs, a little Jack Russell Terrier named Chica, and she is very much a daddy's girl. If I'm in my office, she's under the desk. If I'm in the family room, she's beside me in the chair, and she definitely has to sleep in the middle of the bed at night. My kids often claim that I like the dog better than I like them. Well, yeah, that may be true, but it doesn't mean that I don't love my daughters. She's definitely a spoiled little princess. If we look at the dialogue in that light and imagine it said with a gentle smile, then it seems to make more sense. Many scholars believe that Jesus was not insulting the woman, but softening the words he spoke to her with a metaphor. Either way, her response was brilliant. She reminded Jesus that the little dogs are part of the family and eat with them. In most of the households, people ate with their hands. The juices from their fingers were wiped on pieces of bread that were then thrown on the floor for the household pets. In essence, she was reminding him that the dogs of the household actually ate with the family in that manner. Jesus relents. And here I think Matthew has a better text. Jesus tells the woman that her faith is great, and for that, her daughter was healed. Jesus always responds to faith. Now let's jump forward to the Decapolis. Here it is that Jesus is presented with another Gentile, the deaf mute. The man's speech impediment was probably a result of his deafness. We still see that today in deaf people everywhere. Not having an audible context for the sounds they make, their speech can sometimes come across as garbled. The part of this story that is really striking is the sensitivity with which Jesus helps the man. First, Jesus pulls him to one side. Now, it's said that it's more difficult to be deaf than it is to be blind. While being blind is no easy state of affairs, it is not as isolating as deafness. A deaf person moves through the world knowing that communication is taking place all around them and that they cannot participate. This has been helped by modern sign language, but outside of specific contexts, the deaf person is frequently isolated and helpless. First, Jesus removes the man from that place of isolation. He takes him out of the world in which he is helpless to all that is going on around him, and takes him to a place of privacy. And although we may not initially see it from our perspective, he then communicates to the man all that he is going to do. He first touches the man's ears, indicating that he will heal them. He then touches the man's tongue with spittle. Obviously not very sanitary, but in that time, spittle was considered healing. So Jesus is telling the man he's going to heal his speech. He looks to heaven to indicate that the healing is coming from God, not from himself. He commands the man's organs to open up, and the man is healed. As usual, Jesus charges everyone to be silent about the healing, but I'm sure he knew he was wasting his breath. Jesus had to know that his actions would spread like wildfire. But in his humility, Jesus always asks that people glorify God, not himself. So what do we take away from all this? What do we bring to our lives from these two stories? We already know that Jesus performed healings, but what stands out about these two particular interactions with Jesus? The main takeaways for me are humanity, priority, and faith. If we look at the story of the Syrophoenician woman, I think that we begin to see Jesus address the prejudice felt by the Jews over other ethnic groups or races. Jesus was sent to the Jews, but by his interactions with the woman, we see that he recognizes her humanity and her worthiness. His actual presence in the lands of the Gentiles denies the barriers of ethnicity and challenges the definition of clean and unclean. This is further seen in his physical interaction with the deaf mute, an action that would make him unclean by law. I feel that this demonstrates the truth that we are all equal in the eyes of the Lord. We are all part of the same human family, and we are all equally worthy of God's grace. As James puts it, when we show favoritism or partiality, we become judges with evil thoughts, and we dishonor the second great commandment. Secondly, Jesus emphasizes his priorities. Nothing is more important to Jesus than the ministry he has been given by the Father. Knowing what we now have learned about Jesus, I'm sure he equally wanted to preach to the Gentiles, to bring his message of love and forgiveness to everyone. He loved everyone he met. But that was not the mission. His message was to the Jews, to prepare them for the greater mission to the rest of the world. Nothing interfered with his obedience to that imperative. Equally, we must do the same. Every single person in this congregation, and in fact the world, has been gifted for various ministries. Every single person in this congregation has been called to ministry. No matter how old, no matter how young, no matter rich or poor, no matter what challenges we may have, there is always something we can do for the kingdom of God. God is never done with us. And discerning those tasks and those calls and responding to them is our single greatest priority as a Christian. And last, there's the subject of faith. All of this ties back to our epistle reading from James. It is the faith of the Syrophoenician woman that heals her daughter. It is the faith of the deaf mute's companions that bring him for his healing. We hear time and time again Jesus saying, "Your faith has made you whole." James reminds us, however, that true faith will always result in action. If we really believe that Jesus is our Lord and that he has died for us to ensure our place in the eternal heavenly kingdom, then our faith will not allow us to be unresponsive to the needs of the world. The two aspects of faith and works go hand in hand. Faith begets action. Faith begets healing. Faith begets forgiveness and salvation for all. To be truly Christian To live into a life of true faith, we must respond. Just like Jesus, our reaction to faith must be to heal, to nurture, to forgive, to reconcile. We must recognize and respect all of humanity. We must make a priority of our baptismal covenant and the ministries for which we are gifted and to which we are called. For faith without works is dead. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Having heard the word of the Lord, let's stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Join me in the prayers of the people using Form 3. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let our light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your wonderful kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. We remember especially Bill, Rick, Bruce, John, Judy, Mia, Gail, Linda, Wayne, Trish, Sarah, Susan, Vaughn, Eloni, George, Liz, those victims of fires, floods, hurricanes, not only the victims, but the first responders who care for them. Are there others? In our Anglican cycle of prayer, we remember the province of the Episcopal Church of Sudan. In our diocesan cycle of prayer, we remember the Diocesan Convention. In our parish cycle of prayer, we pray for adult education in the parish and for David, Denise, and David Toman, Bonnie Thorpe, Barbara Jo Thurman, Gail Treacle, Steve, and Ann Turry. We remember those serving in our armed forces, Will Buntain, Kurt Campos, Amanda Finnegan, Stephen Fry, Daniel Fuller, Mary Samantha Katzenberger, Trevor Rankin. We remember our missionaries, the Joel Gray family, the Reverend Susan Hutchins and the very Reverend Mike Wallace, the Reverend Anna Riso, Perry and Samra Mansfield, Sean Martin, the Mustard Seed Babies Home, Young Life Ministries, and Youth and Family Ministries. We pray for the departed, Norm Todd, Willard and Phoebe Thompson, Florence Bowen, Robert and Sadie Pierce, Naomi Jones, Agnes Smith, Naomi Swansboro. Are there others? We pray for our new rector. O God, as we enter a new time in the life of St. Andrew's Episcopal Church, refresh us with a new vision and help us to meet well all duties and responsibilities that come to us. May we show hospitality to our new rector, Father Jonathan Hanneman, and his wife Shannon, and welcome them with our support and prayers. Fill them, O Lord, with the knowledge of your will in all wisdom and understanding. We beseech you for the touch of your Spirit, that his heart may yield to you in obedience, reverence, and confidence. Endue our hearts with gratitude and love for the blessings of this new ministry that will not only give joy and comfort, but also by example and influence will lead others to love and serve you. Impel us constantly through this new ministry to generous acts of kindness done to others in the Master's name, and for his sake, that we may become strength to the weak, hope to the despondent, joy to the sorrowing, power to the tempted, so that we may live that through us your kingdom may in part come, and your will more fully be done among all people. Grant that your servant, Father Jonathan, may find his strength and dedication from the leading of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for the new opportunities that are ours. Help us to meet them with courage and trust in you. May we be filled with the gratitude of the Savior Jesus, who lifts us from the burden of sin and anxiety, and gather this family about yourself and protect us in the name of the one who calls us beyond ourselves, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Taking a moment for reflection, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
It's so nice to have all of you with us today. Welcome. It's so nice to have all of you with us today. I have a few announcements. Nancy, I see you coming on up. That's good.
Good morning. I just wanted to tell you a couple things that are happening soon concerning the Community of Hope. First thing is next Sunday is Second Sunday Supper, and Trinity Lutheran will be joining us. It's going to be at 6 o'clock, hoping to beat the heat a little bit. So if you're interested, bring your favorite casserole dish to Camp Hope. It's down on Amador behind the Community of Hope at 6 o'clock next Sunday, a week from today. And we'll have a potluck dinner with all of the residents at Camp Hope. This brings them not only food, but just that fellowship and saying we want to spend an hour of our time with you is a huge gift that really can't be expressed or valued enough. And the other thing is that Tents to Rents is starting. So Tents to Rents is the Community of Hope's annual fundraiser for Camp Hope. Camp Hope cannot be funded by federal or state funds, so it's 100% funded by private funds. So these monies go to move people from Camp Hope into apartments. It will go to run Camp Hope. It'll also go to pay the security deposits for people who are moving from Camp Hope into the new Desert Hope apartments. Hopefully you saw that in the news. It's an incredible 40 apartment complex that has all the services, wraparound services that people need. So we're also raising money to pay for their security deposits. So anyways, Tents to Rents is a social media campaign. We have one of our heroes from last year, Kristen Knight here, who did a fabulous job last year, and now she's on the committee and pushing us hard to get it done. So what will happen is every week you will receive an email from me through the church, and it'll tell you the story of someone living in Camp Hope, and it'll also show their picture, and it'll, have the donate button where you can donate to our secure site. But we invite you to send that email out to your friends and family and tell them what an amazing ministry this is in Las Cruces. And we're hoping to raise $60,000 to help the people in Camp Hope move into stable housing. So we'll see you at Second Sunday Supper next Sunday, and you'll be hearing from me by email soon. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Nancy. It's a fabulous opportunity for us to partner with a great organization in our community that we helped establish. I'm sure most of you know by now that our dear friend and wonderful, faithful citizen, Norm Todd, died this last week, and his service will be on Tuesday at 12:30 with an interment immediately following. So please join us for that service, if you will, 12:30 here in the sanctuary. Contact tracing forms are on your pews. Please use them. As I just announced to you at the beginning of the service, our dear musician Corey was at a special thing the other night, and he got contact traced that he was in the presence of someone who has subsequently come down with COVID. So he's in the process of being tested, and if he tests negative, then he'll be back with us. Otherwise, he'll need to quarantine for 14 days. So they really are important, and they do help us get back and let people know what might be happening. Father Peter, you have an announcement for us today.
Good morning. I teach classes online. I've been doing this the last year. Bringing people together from Europe and North America on different topics of Christian discipleship, Christian spirituality. I'll be teaching a class starting the end of this month on Christian healing prayer, and I have some papers that explain it. I'll be at the back. Just ask me for one, and or email me with any questions that you may have about the class and how you can participate. Thank you.
It will be a wonderful experience, I'm sure. So check in with Father Peter, or if you want to think about it later, you can let us know and we'll send it to you from the office too. Thank you. Shoeboxes. You all remember our shoebox project? where we take shoeboxes, wrap them so that the lid comes off, and in those shoeboxes goes wonderful goodies for children that will go across the border into Mexico. We're in the process of doing the shoebox project right now, so if you have a mind to take the shoeboxes that you might have at home and wrap them and then fill them with the goodies, do that. Or if you just have shoeboxes to donate, we'll take them and see that they get wrapped. Or if you just have stuff to go in the shoeboxes, we'll take that too. We are flexible. We would like for you to help in any way that you can. So bring whatever you would like into the church. Ring the doorbell at the front of the church between 10 and 1 Tuesday through Friday, and we will be glad to take those donations from you. We're hoping to do about 60 to 100 shoeboxes this year to take down to Paloma. So hang in there with us and let's make that wonderful ministry happen too. I want to take this time to introduce two young men, Bachman and Timon. You want to stand up? There they are. They are going across country and they are working with various churches, and they are trying to visit with Episcopal churches on their travels. So thank you both for stopping by St. Andrews today. Safe travels, do wonderful things, and carry God's word, and peace be with you. Thank you. Ascribe to the Lord the honor. Oops. Okay, please.
Has anyone seen the new bulletin? Total article of the stained glass window in the chapel. It's a cover story, inside, just amazing story. So if you can find the bulletin somewhere, they're laying all over the place. Check it out.
Good, Wayne, thank you. Yes, Frank had told me that this was supposed to be coming out, so I'm glad it's out. It's perfect. We hope to be able to dedicate those windows in November when the bishop comes. So with any luck at all, we'll be able to make all of that happen. Yes, so thank you for your support. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts.
Thank you. eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is dying. Christ is risen. Christ is alive again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and
Christ, keep you in everlasting glory. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you in everlasting glory. Keep you in everlasting life. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you in everlasting life. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you in everlasting life.
Amen. Thank you.
Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you in everlasting life.
Continuing with the post-communion prayer on page 365, please stand as you are able. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world. May God hold you in the palm of his hand. May you become everything that God created you to be. As you rejoice in that creation, may you feel peace in your soul and love in your heart. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and those for whom you pray this day and always. Amen.
Thank you.
back there?
Yeah, there's another. We left another plate back there just for that. Okay, so see you next Monday, not this Monday. Men's Club.